Have you ever tried to memorize in the Greek, or are you only memorizing in the English?
En auge eingologos dialogos Christos Jesus elthon eiston kos.
You just heard from Dr. Timothy Cross. He's the pastor at Cornwall Street Baptist Church in England. And I have to say, I've been doing interviews for a while now here on Bible Memory Goal. I have never had so many verses quoted within such a short period of time. It was fantastic. I had so much fun talking with Timothy during this conversation, and he has so many just little ways of saying things that I thought were interesting. Inking over something that you've penciled in, so many good things. I hope that you'll enjoy this conversation, and we're gonna go ahead and dive in right now.
I used to listen to Trans World Radio, Monte Carlo.
Yeah.
And there was a fellow there called Jack Van Impe, who had memorized, so they said, I mean, he was always trumpeting how many verses, that he memorized 10,000 verses. And I used to admire his ability to quote scripture from memory. So I began in a small way, beginning with just verses. What's the gospel? Well, John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. How are you saved? By grace. Well, by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not because of works, lest anyone should boast. Ephesians 2:8-9. Why did Jesus come? Well, the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Luke 19:10, all this sort of stuff. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. 1 Timothy 1:15. So that, it began that way. And I found it very helpful, you know, assurance of salvation. You know, Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So whether I feel it or not, is the Bible true, or are my doubts true? The Bible is true. You know, it's helped me with assurance. And so it grew and grew. Then I tried to memorize paragraphs, purple patches, I used to call them. So say Colossians 1:15-20 about the Lord Jesus. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for in him all things were created, you know, all these. So that was a blessing. Then it moved on to chapters. I memorized Isaiah 53, you know, again, one of the clearest pictures of Calvary in the Old Testament. He was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that made us whole. With his stripes we're healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So it was a great blessing. And then tentatively, I began to memorize books. I think it began with sort of longer passages like Psalms. You know, Psalm 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the, you know, or an assurance, like a life verse, Psalm 32:1-2, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered, blessed is the man to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity. Mm-hmm. So it began, yes, verses, paragraphs, then let's try and get a whole psalm. And then whole books. So I think I began with Ephesians, which was a blessing. And it's just been a great help to my own personal walk with the Lord. But then as I began preaching as well, it was great to have the ability to quote scripture from memory. It seemed to give my sermons a lot of ballast, you know, that it was not my views or anything. This is what the Word of God says. So, yes, so it's been a great, I mean, I hope I would memorize scripture whether I was a minister or not. I would recommend every believer to memorize as much as you can, really. If you believe in the divine inspiration of scripture, it's great to have it in the mind and heart, you know. Different verses come to you at different times of need. You can claim these promises, you know. At night time when you can't sleep, you know, everything is highly recommended.
Absolutely. So, I'm always very encouraged when I talk to people like yourself. I've talked to others that are in ministry and that do prioritize scripture memory. I actually think that ministers who do memorize is actually a minority, more than I'd like. And I'm curious for you, how do you balance the time? You know, you've got to be studying, you also have responsibilities in the church, but then balance that with this, you know, it does take time to memorize. Like how do you do all
Yeah,
that?
I think sometimes we know more than we think we know just through the familiarity with scripture. But everything is, if you really want to do something, you schedule everything around things, you know. So I run, I pray, read the Bible, and each day it's time. Not so much for memorizing the scripture, but for retaining what I have memorized. The memorizing, sometimes if I go on a holiday, I would try and memorize a new book or new verses, that's one. But I have a set amount of time each day, and I go over what I've done, you know. So it's a joyful form of bondage, you
A
know.
joy.
It's
I like
something I.
that. A joyful form of bondage. I haven't heard it said like that before. What books of the Bible have you memorized, and what's been your favorite so far?
Ooh. Well, Romans is very special because it's the distilled gospel. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So as a Protestant, that's the heart of the gospel, that we are declared righteous because of Christ. In God's sight, unrighteous though I am in myself, I am declared with totally righteous. The righteousness of Christ is put to my account and clothed with that, you know. So when we get to heaven, as we say, by not our own righteousness, but by righteousness of another, an alien righteousness, with the sinless life and sacrificial death of Christ. So Romans is a special book. I'm handicapped more now when I. In my previous abode, a dear godly couple, we were on the same length, and they used to test me on my scriptures, you know. So they were quite happy to hear me chant off books. Now it's more, you know, what as I began, you put a little bit of card over the page. Universe verse one, yes, got that, uncover it, verse two, and that way. That's right. And when I began, I did begin with, I used to write the verses on cards and the reference on the other side. But now I suppose I don't really, I know individual verses from the books, but I can rattle the book off. But I have to run up to some individual verses. I might not be able to quote them cold, you know.
I like that.
So Romans is a special book, but they're all very special, you know. I mean, Galatians really is Romans in embryo. It's, I say, Paul takes up controversially what he explains systematically, because the doctrine of salvation by free grace alone was under threat from the Judaism, those who thought you could be saved by what you do rather than what Christ has done. So yes, I've got quite a few books off my heart, and I would like to have more as well, you know. But I mean, there used to be a chap over here who used to give recitations of Mark's gospel, but that makes me feel inadequate.
Oh, I mean, having all of Romans is not anything to feel inadequate about, that's for sure.
And I remember I think the first lengthy passage I memorized was probably John 1 to 18, the prologue. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. Without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. So yes, but you don't have to be clever really to memorize. It's a very unsubtle form of learning. It's just bashing it in. The hard part is once you've got it, it's easier to retain than to actually get it, I've found. I mean, I'm like a boy who can't do his maths when I'm memorizing. You know, you forget a word, or you put a word in that isn't there, you know. So it's then eventually, so it's just a question of slogging at it, I find, you know. It's worth the struggle, you know. But I believe that, you know, I believe it purifies my mind and heart. You know, we are what we think, you know.
No, I love the fact that memorizing really facilitates the meditation of scripture. And one of the things that you've said to me a couple times as we've interacted before we actually got on this call is that you and technology don't necessarily get along. And I love the fact that, you know, you're a great example of the fact that you can do all of this. You can memorize, you can review without an app, without a computer. And I love that idea of just taking a 3x5 card, and you're saying you're literally just moving it down the page of your Bible. Is that correct?
That's right, yes. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Yes, that's from somewhere. Yes, very nice. Yeah. But, well, I know preachers who take a sort of mobile phone into the pulpit, you know, and they've got their sermon points on there, but I know if I did that, as soon as I got up there, the batteries would go.
Yes.
I have got the Bible on my phone, and it gives me a verse a day sort of thing. But I can't say I read it on the phone. I'm old-fashioned. Just got the book. You know.
Yep.
I mean, my sermons, I always try and look at the original, you know, the Greek and Hebrew. That was probably one of the few things I got out of college. It's nice to look at the original. You might get an extra shade of meaning. I remember when I was really wowed, 1 Corinthians 15, 3-4, I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. That word, the verb, he was raised, is what they call in the Greek the perfect tense. So it doesn't mean just that he, and the perfect tense means an action in the past which has abiding relevance, continuing relevance in the present. So when it says Christ was raised, it means, yes, he was raised, and he is still alive today, a living Savior, you know. So it's little things like that that the Greek can give you a great blessing. I mean, you don't want to be too technical in the pulpit, but the job of the preacher is to bring the meaning of the word and the implications of the word out to the congregation, you know, and strengthen their faith that way, you know. In ourselves, we've got nothing to say. We have to preach the word of God, you know. No new revelation, but the revelation is there to expound. You know?
Yeah. That's one of the reasons why when people ask me about different ideas and thoughts of memorizing, one of the things I love to do is memorize alongside, let's say, my pastor going through a particular passage, because I think that by listening, you know, as I'm memorizing, there are things like that. Like if you had said that I could incorporate into my memory that would make it that much deeper, that my understanding of that passage would be so much better. Have you ever tried to memorize in the Greek, or are you only memorizing in the English?
En arche en hologos, kai hologos, Christos Jesus, elthon eiston kosmon, so kamartolai, so sai. I think I'm translating back into the Greek.
That's fantastic.
You don't know, I don't consciously try to memorize the Greek.
Yeah.
But, you know, when this is our stock in trade, you will get some just sort of in the process of that's where you live, really. And I think that's the same with most Christians, even if they don't consciously try to memorize the Bible, they should at least be familiar with it, with their daily devotions, you know. Whether that's a little portion or a few chapters a day, you know.
So if you're speaking to somebody that is part of your church or a friend who is, let's say, either new in their faith or they just have this new inspiration to want to memorize more, like what are the things that you share with them or ideas or, I don't know, just encouragements that you give them to get started, even if they feel like it's really hard for them?
Yes. Well, I say anything worthwhile is never easy. Whether that's marathon running or learning an instrument. But a new Christian, I do have a passion for doctrinal, being well grounded in the basic fundamentals of the faith. So I would give them a few verses to memorize, on the persons, why do we believe in the deity of Christ? Well, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I mean, it's more than just a memory verse. But the deity of Christ is part of the very woof of the New Testament, I mean, he walked on water, he calmed the troubled sea, he raised the dead, he forgave sins, he fed multitudes, he healed lepers at a touch. These are all proofs of his deity. But there are, great indeed is in the mystery of our religion. God was manifested, and there are direct statements of the deity of Christ. I'd want to do that. Are you sure your sins are forgiven? Well, yes, because you can trust in Christ, Ephesians 1:7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. So I try and get them to memorize some of the basic fundamentals of the faith. And obviously the fundamental of the faith is the substitutionary death of Christ on the cross. What went on at Calvary, the unique sacrifice. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, John 1:29. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, 1 Peter 2:24, that sort of thing. So yes, get a good grounding in the fundamentals. And what's unique about the Bible? Well, I think it's one of the first ones I did memorize. 2 Timothy 3:16, 17, all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Acts 4:12, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Very good thing for new Christians as well is to memorize the I am sayings of Jesus. That's a great help. John 14:6, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. John 8:12, I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. John 6:35, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. John 10:11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. There's such a lot just to meditate on those verses will be a blessing and strengthen your soul, give you assurance,
I'm so curious because one of the things that I'm really loving about our conversation right now is the fact that I think just in the past however many minutes we've been talking, you've probably quoted 20 to 30 different scriptures to me, if not more. And you've done so at a rapid pace. In other words, like it's obvious that it has been ingrained in, your mind, and it is just a part of you. It's not something that you're having to go back and really think about. It just flows off of your tongue. Is that something that
Well,
you found like you?
that's what I would like,
Yeah,
that's
oh,
what
of
I would
course.
like.
Oh,
Because
absolutely.
I
And
mean, discipleship is ongoing. I know conversion might be one off.
yeah.
Although I'm not sure whether that is. I mean, when was the original Timothy saved? He was nurtured in the faith through his mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois. From
Yep.
childhood, you've been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. But then I think probably he inked in what he'd penciled over when he met Paul, because Paul refers to him as my true child in the faith. So I'm not sure when Timothy was converted. Did he know he had a conversion, a distinct conversion? And it might be a bit the same as me with my sort of, I was born into a Christian mum, and then I professed salvation in my later teens, but that might be tidying it up for the telling, as
Well, I
you
think
went.
you said it very well, inking in what was penciled over. Like I think my question for you, and I really want to know is, it rolls off the tongue so much. Is that something that you've consciously worked on, or is that just a product of having gone over it for, I don't know, how many years have you been at this?
Well, I was saved when I'm 18, and now I am
Decades.
now I am a middle-aged man. I can't used to be able to run a marathon in 2:49. Now you'd have to put a calendar on me rather than the stopwatch. I'm not sure. It's obviously the memory verses you do work at. But then you've got a lot more than you think you have just through familiarization with the scriptures, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, passages I've preached on, you, I mean, the first rule when I'm preparing a sermon is absolutely soak yourself in the passage. What does it say? What does it mean?
Mm.
How does it apply? Is there any way I can illustrate it? You know, is there a promise here to claim? Is there a warning to heed? You know, is there a blessing? You know, what does it say about the person of the Lord Jesus Christ? What does it say about salvation? What does it say about Christian living? You know, what am I to do with it? What do I hope my flock will get out of it? You know,
yeah.
So that you really have to work at it. And then, you know, I'm not arrogant to say I do look at what commentators have said, you know, because we've got this great Christian heritage. You know, it's very arrogant to think not to look at those, you know. And of course, my interpretation might be, but I believe most scripture is plain, you know. Protestants believe in the perspicuity of the scripture. The scriptures are clean. I think it was Mark Twain who said, it's not so much what I don't understand in scripture that worries me, it's what I do understand. That's the first thing I do in sermon praises. You really grapple with the passage or the verse, the incident, whatever it is, however you preach, you know. I tend to preach, I believe in expository preaching, covering whole books.
Mm-hmm.
But that of course depends then on people being there regularly, and sometimes people are rather sporadic in their church attendance. But other times it's one-offs, you know, a psalm here, a verse here, gospel sermon here, pastoral sermon here. But each time, you know, I hope I really know and am familiar with the passage I'm trying to expound and explain. I hope I will be a student of the scriptures to my dying day. Another thing is slightly sensitive. My late father died of dementia, which was very upsetting because he was very able in his day.
Yeah.
Just a shadow of himself. And I learned a lot then about Alzheimer's disease, about the long-term memory and the short-term memory.
Mm.
And the long-term memory is the last to go. Things that are ingrained are still there. Forget something you told him 2 minutes ago. So I'm hoping if I go that way, that the memory verses will still be there even when everything else has gone, you know.
Yeah.
So, it's in the Lord's hands, you know. I hope it's not something I would want, Alzheimer's disease, but it's more and more common.
Yeah. No, my grandmother, I remember going through that same thing and watching her mind deteriorate, and, you know, things that, you know, she'd done decades ago, those she could remember just off the top of her mind. But the fact that I was her grandson might have slipped her memory. So I think that's really neat, being able to look at it from the perspective of, I want these things to be so deep in the memory that even when half of my memory is gone, that's still there.
I think that gave me a sort of urgency as well to carry on the memorization.
Mm.
I don't know, you shouldn't worry about what if, but I don't want those to go, you know, even if everything else goes.
Yeah. Thank you for joining me and Timothy Cross for this conversation on scripture memory. If you want to learn more about him, the different books that he's published, you can go to timothyjcross.org. You'll find everything about him there. Thank you so much for taking time out of your day to watch. If you aren't subscribed to this channel, go ahead and do that now. And you can watch more great interviews that we've done with other amazing practitioners of scripture memory.